I read a story recently about a mom that went in to tuck her young son into bed. And as she went in, it was summertime and the windows were open and he was lying there and one of the summer storms was coming up, so it was thundering and lightning was crackling across the sky, and of course through the drapes it created all kinds of shapes in the room, and the wind was blowing and you could hear the branches rubbing up against the house. And she had tucked him in and kissed him goodnight and pulled the covers up, and as she was leaving the room and getting ready to turn off the light, the little boy said up and out from under the covers and said, "Mommy, will you stay here with me tonight?" And she says, "Well, I can't, son. I have to go sleep in Daddy's room, but you'll be just fine." And so she switched off the light, and as she stepped out into the hall, she heard her little son's voice say, "The big sissy." That little fellow was frightened, just like many of us are when we were that age. Things we didn't understand, the thunder, the lightning, insects, snakes, whatever. We had our fears. I tell you, if you've lived in the South long enough, no doubt you have pulled up to an intersection beside a pickup truck that has very many added parts to it and sits up high off the ground like you almost need a stepladder to get into it. And chances are, there's more mud than paint on it, and there might even be a flag the size of the truck flying off the back bumper, and there's a decal on the window that says, "Ain't scared, ain't scared." And you pull up, and that driver, you just know he's a Southerner. You know, he's got the neck tattoo. Nothing against tattoos. He got the neck tattoo and the rat tail and the beer gut. You just know it. But anyway, you just know he is. And what he's trying to tell everybody with all of his toys and his messages and all is that he isn't afraid of anything or anybody. If we're honest with ourselves, we all have our own personal fears. There are things that we don't share with even our most intimate friends or our spouses, and things that frighten us, things that we're afraid of. But this morning, we're going to continue looking at Peter's letter. First letter he wrote to a group of Gentiles that had been scattered out throughout the known world at the time. And these are folks that were not being persecuted by the government, but by their friends and family and employers. They were Christians. They were being persecuted simply because they were Christians. And we keep talking about hope in the season of hope. And we're going to look at some more thoughts on hope. And last week we talked about finding some hope in our identity. And how we are so loved and so special to God that we have hope in being identified as a child of God. And nobody can take that away from us. Nobody can take that identity away from us. We are who God created us to be, and therefore we are God's children. And there's no one out there that can take that away, and so we find hope in that identity. And I want to move on a little further this morning and discover that we have nothing to fear in this world because our hope lies in who is in charge. I know the longest time there was a saying that went, "Large and in charge," you know, and it was talking about, you know, who's the boss, who really controls the situation. So if you want to follow along with me in Peter's letter, we're continuing in 1 Peter chapter 3. We'll begin reading with verse 13, I invite you now to hear the Word of God. Now, who will want to harm you if you are eager to do good? But even if you suffer for doing what is right, God will reward you for it. So don't worry or be afraid of their threats. Instead, you must worship Christ as Lord of your life. Now hear this. And if someone asks about your Christian hope, always be ready to explain it. But do this in a gentle and respectful way. I think there are a lot of folks that don't have that verse in their Bible. They forget what they're being told to do. If someone asks you about your Christian hope, be ready to explain it always, but do it in a gentle and respectful way. Keep your conscience clear. Then if people speak against you, they will be ashamed when they see what a good life you live because you belong to Christ. Remember, it is better to suffer for doing good, if that is what God wants, than to suffer for doing wrong. Christ suffered for our sins once for all. He never sinned, but He died for sinners to bring us safely home to God. He suffered physical death, but He was raised to life in the Spirit. So He went and preached the spirits in prison. Those who disobeyed God long ago, when God waited patiently while Noah was building his boat, only 8 people were saved from drowning in that terrible flood. And that water is a picture of baptism, which now saves us, not by removing dirt from our body, but as a response to God from a clean conscience. It is effective because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now Christ has gone to heaven, and this is what I want you to hear today. He is seated in the place of honor next to God, and all the angels and authorities and powers accept His authority. This is the end of our reading for today. This is the Word of God, and it can be trusted.
Thanks be to God.
As I mentioned last week, Peter's letter of encouragement for the Christians that had been spread out across the world wasn't sent because they were being tortured. It wasn't sent because they were being put to death by the government or the Roman government. Actually, the Roman government was in decline at this time. So they were actually being publicly mocked and ridiculed by their neighbors, by their friends, their family, their employers. And if you think about it, none of us likes to be ridiculed, especially when it comes to those deeply seated beliefs that we hold or our faith. So, we don't like being publicly ridiculed. We don't like being humiliated. We don't like being told, you're wrong and I'm right. It makes the hair stand up on our back of our necks, and we're ready to go to battle over that. You know, for Peter's readers, being identified as Christian was not the mainstream at the time. And I think sometimes we forget that. We forget that when these Christians were striving to follow Christ in their world, they were the minority. They were the upstarts. They were the ones that followed the revolutionary. So for his readers, being identified as Christian was certainly not popular. It wasn't mainstream, much like it is for us today. And so they were enduring mockery, they were enduring ridicule, they were being humiliated, they were being denied employment, they were being denied the ability to sell their goods. So perhaps if we were the religious minority, or if we did actually fear some harm because of who we worship, we might have a little more respect for that wonderful thing that we call religious freedom. I think we just simply take it for granted that we have religious freedom and we don't really appreciate it as much as we should. There are so many countries out there right now where there is no religious freedom. You are told what to believe and you get pushed off a 9-story building and you get your head cut. cut off if you don't believe it. So I think, you know, we need to take a moment, especially with Memorial Day coming up, and think about how lucky we are to live in a country that has religious freedom. I also think of our Muslim neighbors and what they must go through here in America, too. Especially now with the way things are coming out and being spoken of. And I think that at one time that maybe was what it was like to be a Christian. If we think about the way so many Muslims are treated in America today, that very well could be what it was like to be a Christian when Peter was writing his letter. Let's face it. We don't have to face fear because of who we worship very often, do we? So why aren't more of us willing to be open about who we are and what we believe? Why do we hide it under a bushel? Why do we not want to be that city on the hill? I think one of the reasons that we don't face a lot of scrutiny about our beliefs is because of where we live. You know, of course, about anywhere you are in the South, they'll say you're the buckle of the Bible Belt. But I think we're pretty close to the buckle of the Bible Belt here in the upstate of South Carolina. But I think it's even due more to the fact of who we hang out with. Don't most of us hang out almost exclusively with other Christians? Or at least with people who are liberal enough to not care whether we're a Christian or not. Don't we? By not facing a lot of fear of being an out and proud Christian, perhaps we have a little trouble relating to those folks who are hearing Peter's words. Maybe we're even like the Christians who are living in a predominantly Islamic nation and having to hide where we go to church and not let anyone know that we have Bible. Perhaps we should ask ourselves, what kind of suffering do we endure because of who Christ is in our lives? Have you ever asked yourself that? Have you ever really thought about what kind of suffering have I ever endured in the name of Christ Jesus? What have we had to do to take a pass on? What did we have to just not do simply because we were a Christian and we were bold enough to say, I'm sorry, I can't do that because I'm a Christian. I'm trying to follow Christ and I don't believe that's the right thing for me to do. What have we had to stand up for? When have we had to say, this is just wrong? This is just wrong. It's evil and it's wrong. And Christ would not let me be silent about it any longer. What if we had to give up to follow the standards set by Jesus? In other words, how have our lives been impacted by our Christianity? Are we happy to just keep that salvation card in our back pocket and move merrily through this world knowing that one day we'll die and we'll go to heaven? Are we actually trying to do something to make an impact for Jesus Christ? And take it a little step further. How out and proud are we as either a gay or a gay-affirming Christian? You know, some of us might have lost a friend, or maybe we have a strained relationship with our family or our co-workers by being gay or gay-affirming. Maybe that's happened to you. I don't know. Peter tells us that suffering for doing what is right will have its rewards. I encourage us all to remember that we should never be afraid to be on the right side of history or the right side of belief. God has rewards in store for us. We don't know what they are, but we know that every good and perfect gift comes from the Father. And so if we're getting all the good and perfect gifts here, can you only imagine what's in store for us in the days to come? I encourage us to replace any fear and anxiety that we may have with hope. To not be afraid, because that's the message that Peter was bringing to those he was writing to. Now, Peter is not encouraging us to go out and seek suffering. He's not telling us to go looking for trouble. But he is telling us to not let suffering that we do face replace our hope. Hope of who we are, who we belong to, and who is in charge. You know, we humans are awfully weak sometimes. A little bit of pressure and we can cave in and give up if troubles surround us. There are people in our lives right now, and I know we all know them, who might be in an abusive relationship, or they refuse to accept help, or they get the assistance they need, or refute false doctrine because of the letters of Peter. This passage of Scripture, as well as much of Peter's letter, has been misused over centuries and centuries and centuries of theology, and it has been used to justify some pretty ugly situations. It's been used to justify slavery. It's been used to justify oppression. It's been used to justify the submission of women. It's been used to justify other real suffering that people have faced in history and are still facing today. I know we feel so safe over here in the United States, but when you go to sub-Saharan Africa and you see all the militias that are over there that are killing people just because they're Christian and using scripture to justify what they're doing, we know that that's not right and we have to stand up and speak out about it. But this letter from Peter has been used to justify awful things in our history. And we know that it's not what he meant. That is not what he meant at all. There are too many people out there preaching that a good Christian must endure suffering as their lot in life without trying to change it because, oh, you'll get a bigger and better reward. I think I said something last week about jewels in your crown that I was raised with. You know, do good because you're going to get more jewels in your crown when you get to heaven. Well, I don't care how many jewels are in my crown. I'm going to be casting my crown at the feet of Jesus. So it doesn't really matter how many precious stones are in that crown. What we need to do is make sure that we're speaking out about what is right and what is wrong. Now, Peter does tell us that, yeah, if you're doing that, if you're speaking out about what's right, what is wrong, you're going to run into opposition. There's going to be some possible suffering out there for you. But if you're doing the right thing, there is a reward for you. He isn't telling us to put up with some harsh master in this lifetime to gather jewels for a crown of glory sometime in the future. He's not telling us to stay in abusive relationships. He's not telling us to let someone oppress us. He is not telling us that that's our lot in life. That is not what he is saying. He is saying, if you are living for Jesus Christ, you will experience some opposition to living that lifestyle. If you say, empty me and fill me with more of you, and that more of you comes out, and you stand up against what is wrong, you will receive opposition. Because when you go along to get along, the Satan's not going to mess with you. He's going to leave you alone. But you're doing just what he wants you to do. Don't be messing with him. He's going to follow the crowd. But when you stand up and you say, this is evil, this is wrong, this is not right, he's going to send all of his demons out to attack. He's encouraging us to keep a positive attitude about our faith, be willing to speak out in a gentle and respectful way. I think Peter observed firsthand as he followed Jesus exactly how to address those who were in power, who abused and coerced. Peter knows that good Christians do not keep quiet when injustice and wrongs exist. We do our part to make the necessary changes or at least give our best efforts in doing so. It's not an invitation to be a floor mat and get walked on, but it is an invitation to be an active participant in sharing the good news of the freedom in Christ Jesus. And to say, I am not afraid because Jesus Christ has already paid the price for my freedom. We're not called to be weenies. But we know something is wrong. And we know we have to speak out about it. We know that we might suffer because of it. Peter says, be strong and be bold. Remember what Jesus went through to buy our pardon. We're to live without fear. Because our guaranteed future and the promise of life that we share in Christ our brother. At the very end of our passage today, what did I say? That Jesus Christ is sitting at the right hand of the Father, and He has all authority and all power. And all the angels and all know it. All the authorities know that He has all the power. Death has been defeated. Satan has been defeated. He's still out there roaming around, but he has been defeated. We're to live life without fear because of our guaranteed future and the promise of life that we share with our brother who is sitting at the right hand of the Father. Think about it this way. How brave would all of us be to go out into our communities and our daily lives if we had a big brother who we knew had all the authority, controlled all the power, and had dominion over everything? We'd be strutting our stuff, wouldn't we? We'd be out there walking around like, you can't touch me. So I've got news for you, folks. Our big brother does have all the power and all the honor and all the glory that goes along with it. He has all the authority. And one day, He's going to wield that power and He's going to wield that authority. And every single person that has persecuted His brothers and sisters will be punished. We might not see it, but we can rest assured that it will happen. I think one of the greatest hopes that a Christian can have is not living in fear. There are too many people in this world who live every day in fear of something. One of the greatest hopes that a Christian can have is not living in fear. So my word to you this morning is don't be afraid. Live like Jesus commanded us with a clear conscience. Your future. Be strong and be bold. All in Christ's name. Amen. Amen.